lead us to believe that a new drainage superintendent may come up with a new way to assess the costs. That would have to go through the process as well, but that may be what we bring back to council. The works that were done in 2016 were done under the 1999 bylaw and need to be built out based on that 1999 bylaw.
Okay. No more questions from council. We do have some delegations, so I'll invite Mr. Tom Dick up first. That's fine. All right, so we've got Tom Dick, Ken Ham, and John Landshut.
1110 Mercy Road 1, Tom Dick, members of council and Mr. Mayor, Deputy Mayor. All I want to say, when we're going back to this report in 1973, it was a 90-10. That's my understanding at that time. What they did is Mr. Setterington, after the wall was put in by the federal government, then Mr. Setterington came into the picture and then came the drainage under the Drainage Act, okay? 1999, this thing was supposed to be gone, that we weren't all supposed to be responsible as landowners for that because it was protecting the homes. And all of a sudden, when Rob brought that to my attention, I was not aware of that. But anyways, the thing that I'm concerned about is the fact that all of a sudden, I open my taxes and I see these, you know, I've got close to $9,000 bill here for damages, you know, and I'm thinking, what is going on, you know? So then I went and talked to Luann. She says, well, I had that taken care of, that, you know, and I says, well, who wanted it? I think it was the property owners, you know, for their homes. So bottom line is that fair to us? I mean, we were never notified, never given any notification. Whenever there's a drainage issue, we are always, you know, we have on-site meetings, and there was nothing, absolute nothing. So to me, I'm thinking, this isn't right. You know, how did this thing come so fast in here? $80,000, and then charging us, it's a lot of money. And there's a lot of people in the audience here can't afford this, you know? And I just want to say, if there's a way that we can somehow work this out, that this can go disappear, you know, because those people who have those homes are more than willing to pay their fair share, you know? So, and you go buy those properties, and as I got, you know, notification of where the properties were and everything else, you see what was done there, and you look, how is that any different? There's not much difference at all, you know? And when you look at that, what they did there, the work, you know? And bottom line is, a lot of those properties were pushed down, a lot of them, including the one in this here was the push down, so.
Okay. So was it, Tom, if you don't mind, was it your thought that it was like a shoreline protection thing, it was only there for a period of time, and then it would be gone?
Yeah,
is that what you said?
Right, because when the federal government put it in originally, you know, they said, okay, shoreline's there, it's taken care of. You know, farmers, we paid 10% at that time, and 90% was paid by the federal government.
Mm-hmm.
So bottom line, we're just looking at the fact that I was shocked when this was said, this was supposed to be for shoreline protection. This, the reason Luann went out there to bill this to us was shoreline protection. And you know what? You can abandon this thing, as far as I'm concerned. You can abandon the whole thing, keep us right out. And I'm not afraid to say that, you know, we're going to be fine, even with the water levels the way they are now. Because as, you know, was mentioned, when you got John Ammon and Bill Dunn had gone down and looked at that lot that has never had any stone. That was never removed. There was never stone there, Rob. Never. And I wanted you to come out there, and one day we'll go out there and take a look at that. But there's never been nothing there whatsoever. And the problem is, you know, and you look at that, and that's on Hillman Marsh, and yet we're responsible, according to that map, we're responsible for that too. And yet that's protecting the Hillman Marsh, you know. And there was a landowner at the very end who fixed up his own property at the very end last year, you know, and I don't know what happened to that bill. At least we didn't get it.
Let me ask you this then, if we abandoned it, which I assume could be part of the next report, and the water comes over and floods out your fields, are you going to be back here giving us heck for not protecting
it? No, we'll take care of it ourselves.
Yeah? If you get permission from IRCA? Yeah. So All right, let me just do one of you at a time here, Ken. So were there any other questions from Tom? If not, then Ken.
Ken Ham, 1608 Road 2, Leamington, Mayor and Council. Seems like when we get down to East Marsh and talk about drainage and break wall protection, we kind of lose our common sense. We lose a kind of our ability to decipher one from the other. And this has gone on for a long time. And when we have an engineer's report for a bigger project, it's hard to pick apart what's flood protection, what's drainage, and we have a hard time picking apart costs, so we struggle with that. This one seems to be pretty clear to me, and I know because of the Drainage Act, that's making this a gray area, but when it comes to drainage, we pay based on our area, and we have no problem with that as farmers. When it comes to flood break wall or flood protection, whatever you want to call it, that should be based on your assessed value of whatever you're protecting. Whether I have a $300,000 farm of bare land, or maybe it has a barn on it, or whether you have a $300,000 house sitting there, you should pay the same for flood protection or break wall protection, okay? In fact, I could argue, but it's not really a fair way to argue, that my bare land has less exposure because if it does flood, the water will recede, or we'll pump it off, and we're going to pay to pump it off. And if I don't have a crop on it at that time, I haven't lost a lot. If I do, I have lost a lot, but I also have other insurance for that. Again, it's like insurance. Break wall is like insurance. When we buy insurance for our cars, our homes, anything that we have value, it's all based on the value. And we all have an impact assessment of the value of our property, whether it's a house, a barn, or bare land. So why do we always have to get this down to the landowners paying for things based on their area? Because we pay for our drainage based on area, and that's what we should do. But for anything else, including flood protection, we should not be paying on the area. You should be paying on your assessed value on your taxes, and that's pretty simple to come up with.
Okay.
That's my argument. You know, that's going straight to the end of it, why we should not be getting charged these kind of dollars. And the next time the break wall needs repair, we're going to be right back at it again.
Okay. John?
The last and the youngest spokesperson at the table.
Ouch.
But anyway, John Landshut, 2035 Road B. I've been living in, and I just want to address Mayor, Deputy Mayor, and the Council, of course. Thanks for the opportunity. For me, though, it's two or three things altogether, perhaps. Number one, and Mr. Sharon has already referred to it, many of the owners along the lake have altered the armor stone along this particular shoreline. We don't know who did it. We know that some of them are lower, some of them are higher, some of them don't even have any armor stone, as we know about that one property. So now we're responsible for 40 years of changes since 1973, since 1999, since it perhaps was last assessed. We're now responsible because a new owner, a new property owner thinks that maybe the armor stone needs to be a little taller or a little wider to protect what? His cottage. If there wasn't a home along the shoreline, right, as we see along the Hillman Marsh, north of all of these particular cottagers, there is no armor stone protecting Hillman Marsh. The armor stone is only virtually where there's cottages. Ironic? Maybe. I don't think so. So if there wasn't any homeowners along this particular shoreline, we wouldn't have had Luann to go out. Somebody obviously called her. Somebody obviously said, hey, I think that my armor stone's shifting. I think I'm settling here a little bit. Please come and assess it, right? That's my number one concern. There's been changes, alterations, and now there's new expectations, perhaps by new owners. I have a big concern. Second thing is, every time we want to spend $5,000 in our particular schemes, we have to have, and Tom's already mentioned it, a site meeting. I've got a small ditch in front of my property. We just had a site meeting. It's probably going to be a $20,000 or $30,000 cost to the, I think it's going to be, and Luann could perhaps estimate far better than what I can, but let's say it's going to be $20,000 or $30,000 cost. It's a small ditch. A few culverts have to get changed. We have a site meeting. We get an engineer's report. We get an assessment. $20,000 or $30,000. We've just spent $95,000, including tax. without notification to the people who are going to bear the biggest burden of the cost. That's a huge concern of mine. Until, like, we opened up, Tom opened up for his first because he's a little bit closer to town. I got my assessment a few days later. Tom called me right away and said, John, have you received your latest tax assessment for this particular period? I said, no, I haven't. What should I be looking for? He says, when you open it, call me, right? You're going to be very surprised. Sure enough, for my property, we own about 100 acres in that area, of almost a $5,000 bill. Two properties along the shoreline, right? It's a big bill. Nobody was aware of it until we got the assessment. So between fall of 2006, when all of this occurred, and we get our assessment, there was nothing to inform the landowners that you're going to be receiving a large bill on your assessments because of the shoreline protection that we did under our own, I guess, supervision, a direction. That concerns me. The last thing is again, since I've been living in that area since 1990, John Andrazik was there. Him and I had many, many conversations about what happened in 1973. John, Eugene Whalen, and the whole team went to bat. That thing cost millions of dollars back then to put that armor stone in place. As Rob Doherty indicated, 80%, John Andrazik told me it was 90% funded by the PCs at the time. Liberal government, at the time. So, you know what, 10% share, not a big deal with all of that was being done back then. If we were only going to get assessed 10% of this cost, we probably wouldn't be here today. But we're being assessed the largest portion, no awareness, no involvement. For some reason, we seem to think that every now and again, we can go off on our own and not involve everybody who's going to pay the actual cost of the work that would be done in the next month or two or three. So those are my concerns. Thanks for listening.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Sharon, do you want to address any of those points?
Yes, Mayor Patterson. You know, certainly that we appreciate what these gentlemen are saying, and certainly that's why we want to, you know, take some time to spend some more time on this file, frankly. It wasn't an issue for a number of years until we had to do some work and some emergency work. And I know that the definition of emergency is somewhat subjective, but the drainage superintendent and people involved with the file at the time deemed that if they didn't act, there was going to be significant issue happen, perhaps damage to property, damages to the homes, more work that would have to be done on the break wall if we let it go. So it was done under an emergency repair. But again, it's certainly not our intention to do that again. If there is a significant issue that we feel we have to address, we will go through some engagement as quickly as we can, because certainly if it's an emergency, it's an emergency. We have to act quickly. And we're going to review the file because they're right. A large portion of this was paid for by upper levels of government. I think we did use the inflation calculator and figured out, you know, we're likely talking $5.5-6 million worth of work in 2017 dollars based on what was done in 1973. So it's a substantial piece of infrastructure, and it does have issues, as was mentioned. People have altered it. People have done things to it. So really understanding, you know, how do we deal with this infrastructure going forward? And that's our intention, and we plan to go through the file and have those types of discussions, especially with the scheme. It's their infrastructure that was built. It was built for the scheme, and it's owned by the scheme. And right now, because it's under the act, it's the scheme's obligation to maintain it. So we have to figure out a practical way forward.
So this sounds to me like one of those gifts that keep on giving. When we accept federal and provincial money to help us out, the ongoing maintenance still remains with us, not with them. So to me, that's what defeats your 10% assessment, the 90-10%, because they gave us a gift, for lack of better words, and the ongoing maintenance of it is ours. Right.
Well, it's yours, but it's ours too. Right?
Well, that's what I mean. Right. I'm including all of us together.
But I'm not too worried about, you know, if there wouldn't have been no home, like he had said, guess what? We wouldn't even be here, because you wouldn't even be doing anything to there.
Well, I don't know. I don't know what the emergency was. And
you wouldn't be.
The one property has zero protection.
Yep.
And it's still there.
If the owner were to call today and say, I want armor stone, what would you do about it? It has never had protection since since I've been there in 1990.
Yeah.
I'm sure that Tom can say it's never had protection.
I know the property you're talking about.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So why do we believe?
Sorry. Why do we believe that we have to quickly, under the emergency status, quickly resolve one issue that other properties are living without any protection, altered protection, right? And yet we've got two properties saying, I need to get it done now, without any type of a consultation with the landowners mm-hmm. who are going to bear the biggest share, right? I mean, so I can appreciate Mr. Sharon's comment about, we're going to look at the file, we're going to look at back to 1973. We've got property tax statements currently in our homes that are due probably tomorrow, maybe the next day. I'm not sure when they're due, to be honest. My wife handles all the finances, thank God. But they're due. So do we hold off on paying those charges until there's a full review with your endorsement? Because we've got $85,000 pending to be spent by the landowners, or do we pay it now and talk later? We would have rather talked last fall when this was being brought up with the potential cost. As I mentioned, every time that we're involved in scheme upgrades, site meetings, reports, three quotes, everybody's involved, everybody knows what's happening. These two cottage owners with Luann, bang, 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 done. Here's your tax assessment. Please pay your bill. It's a little tough to swallow, to be very honest.
Again, I don't know if that was the process or not. So
well, I'll ask Luann.
I don't
we
know,
were
Mr.
never involved.
Sharon, was that the process? Is that, or did we get notified?
The way in which the superintendent has the authority to do what she did.
Yes.
And I think that's important. We don't intend for future considerations to react in the same way. That's somewhat with the benefit of hindsight. The works that were done in 2016 are done and paid for, and they were done under the existing bylaw in 1999. So I'm going to suggest that the bills are appropriate and they need to be paid. But our commitment is to appreciate what the landowners are saying and recognize that we have a very complex and challenging situation to deal with. It's not as easy as just saying, you know, well, it's not kept up down here, so why bother keeping it up there? Let's just get rid of the works. We don't need it. We'll look after ourselves. It's not that simple. We do need to have a professional look at it. There is the consideration, like Mr. Hamm was referencing, and we have seen some, you know, recent recommendations to put flood protection assessments on, not just look at it from a pure area and drainage perspective, but to put a value on the fact that, you know, something like this Armorstone Dike, you know, does add additional value to these small lots that have homes on them. And the 1999 report somewhat addressed that, though, again, it was still based on area. So even though, you know, occupied cottage lands on the waterfront were paying something like, you know, 5-6 times. Forgive me, it's in my notes somewhere, but they pay substantially more on an area basis. Because the lots are so small, it still ends up being a quite minimal allocation of the total cost. So the 99 report somewhat addressed that. We're thinking that there may be an opportunity to revisit that, and that attaching more value and then more assessment to the waterfront cottages may be a recommendation for a future report. But again, we need to sit and talk to a drainage engineer before we come to council, and we need to understand it a little bit better as well before we come to council and say appoint this engineer under a Section 76 report, because you know, we wouldn't want simply the 1999 schedule to be regurgitated and council told, you know, it's appropriate. You spent that money paying for a new assessment schedule and it didn't have any desired outcome.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions from council at all? Councillor Hammond.
Worship, thank you. I guess we're kind of at a stalemate here because, Rob, I mean, you can't get a report ready for us, I'm sure, in the next God knows how long. So to the question asked by John, what happens now? What happens to this tax assessment that they've received? I mean, these three gentlemen have made some valid points. So how do we address those tonight?
I don't think they can be addressed tonight, Counselor. You know, our recommendation would be that the assessments need to be paid. There's nothing that, even if a new assessment schedule was prepared and it went through the proper legal process and adopted by council, that would only apply to future works. You cannot retroactively assess works legally under the act. You can't do that. So those 1999, those works were done under the 1999 assessment schedule, and they should be billed out under the 1999 assessment schedule.
No other questions? Tom?
I just, you know, Rob, the other day when I came to see you, I was a little bit hard on you, and I'm sorry, but, you know, if someone, this kind of money, it's a lot of money, you know, and the administration, you know, went ahead and just did it. And that's the part I'm thinking maybe Peter or some of these guys want to take out of their paycheck for a while, see how that works, because it's coming out of our paycheck.
Yeah. Well, and I'm, as you've probably been past my property, I'm having a new culvert and bridge put in for me, too.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know what's all
23
about.
Grand I didn't want to have to come up with either, so.
Right.
You know, but that's what's happening. So it's under the Drainage Act. It's got to be replaced. It's falling apart.
Yeah.
So,
but you know what the thing is?
You had
no notification about the whole thing.
Yeah, right? I almost went through it.
Right?
Yes.
Right. So we had nothing. All of a sudden, we open up our tax, and here it is.
There you go. Yep.
And that's not right about this administration doing this to us. That's not right.
I can't answer that charge. Again, Rob, I guess that's their biggest beef tonight, is that notification was not given. So is there an answer to that one, or is this just, again, something we've learned and we'll deal with?
Mayor Patterson, I think the best response I can give them, and I know it's not going to satisfy them, is that, you know, we don't plan on doing any future work without the discussion. Again, the drainage superintendent didn't do anything wrong. She acted within her authority to do, you know, what she did. But again, we're not insensitive to the fact that it's a complex issue and it's a lot of money. Armor stone break walls are very expensive, as we've seen. So, and we are sensitive to that. I think the best we can do, again, is to commit to that dialogue on a go forward, up to and including bringing potential maintenance issues in front of council, where we would typically make that decision as administration to do the work or not do the work. We'd bring it in front of council if it's a contentious issue and seek council's approval on how they wish us to act. Again, given the fact that the municipality is legally obligated to behave in a certain way.
I guess I have one more further comment. I just find it difficult that we believe one person can spend $85,000 of our money without really getting us involved. I don't believe that there was any of the landowners that were intimately going to fall into the lake within the next month or two. And I could probably walk there, and I'm sure that all of you could as well. I don't think that the armor stones were rolling into the lake, caving into the lake, and the cottage was sitting there teetering. So emergency needs to be defined, right? Because then we could get involved. If we would have gotten involved last fall, what we've just talked about moving forward would have involved this particular assessment, right? We're not talking a bill of $5,000 collectively. We're talking a bill of $80,000 to $85,000, right? Maybe to some of you, it's not a lot of money. For me and my family, it's a lot of money because it was really, really unexpected, right? If it was a $50 assessment, we would come and pay our property tax and go home, right? We're talking a lot more than that, right? And for some of us who own, you know, more than a few acres in that area, it's really a largely a multiplier of costs and to be surprised with it. So when Tom called me and said, have you opened your tax bill? I couldn't wait to get it because he sort of, you know, he sort of led me into saying, you're going to see an assessment worth so many dollars per acre multiplied by the number of acres, and that's going to be your additional cost for this break wall repair. So again, I think that, you know, we can certainly say learn, should have, could have, would have, hindsight. The reality is you expect us to pay a bill that's in thousands of dollars, right? That's just a really difficult thing to take and to swallow, to be honest.
Okay. Councilor Dunn.
Through you, Your Worship, I'd just like to make a statement. I understand where Luann came from at that point because my property on Point Pelee Drive lost all the armor stone during the last storm about 4 weeks ago. And to have Cobby Marine come in, he said, you need a couple loads, it's going to be over $10,000. Yet the shock was just on top of everything else we're down there is outrageous. But the thought of actually losing the rest of my break wall, completely tearing out the concrete wall, was that, because you're seeing the waves crashing against that was just outrageous. And so I can understand that, but that decision I had to make, like you're saying, is to be a part of it, was to make how much am I going to spend? And then I decided only one load, and it was at $5,100. And still, that was a kick in somewhere, but that's beside the point. But yeah, I understand it. But I can understand the emergency point of it if when you come to the fact that you see those waves coming in and it's washing stuff right away and it took it right out. So. Well, with that in respect, I did multiply it out and it came out to about 800,000, that same amount. So it's within the ballpark for that amount. That's my statement anyway.
Anyway, we do have a motion to receive this report. And what if I'm hearing correctly, admin is going back to review this file for future plans, correct? Okay. So we do have a recommendation of Board of Council's assessment is based on 1999 and the Drainage Act, yes. So.
Yes, my one comment would be, doesn't any of the council people feel that we were treated unfairly with respect to this assessment and this work being done? And that there shouldn't be some recognition that, you know what, we should not bear the entire cost, because a process that I would have thought would have been followed for this amount of money wasn't even discussed with us.
I'm not a professional in the Drainage Act, but I do know the Drainage Act is just that, and it dictates what our staff must do. And I think Mr. Sharon has addressed that several times, that we are required to act based on what our drainage superintendent sees. So it's, like I say, it's that gift that keeps on giving. And so, yeah, as crappy as this is, the law says this is the way it is. So I understand where you're coming from, but I don't see us doing anything differently at this point. So what are council's wishes then? Recommendation to receive the information. Pardon? You don't have to have a motion? Oh, okay. Well, it's up to you though. Councillor Wilkinson, did you want to move to receive? Okay. Support by Deputy Mayor. Comment?
Our hands are tied. We have rules we have to follow. And ultimately, who's going to pay for it? Somebody has to pay for it. It can't be the rest of the taxpayers. Drainage Act doesn't allow it. We understand your plight, but 3 weeks ago, we had people here that didn't want to pay for sewers. We are always walking this tight wire. It is never easy, because we're ratepayers as well. We have our, the cat gets to kick us at some point in time as well. I sometimes wish we could go back to the Ken Schmidt days and flood the whole thing. Honest to God, it has certainly crossed my mind, because it just keeps repeating to us and we cannot fix it. There isn't a person up here that doesn't get it. We understand this. But can we do anything about it? No. We've been told we can't do anything about it. The bill has to be paid. We can recognize, yes, maybe that wasn't right, that that's what happened. But it happened, and we have to go forward. The consolation is that we'll look at it, that your comments were taken to heart and to mind, and we'll go forward from that. But to think we're callous here and we don't care is wrong. And you should know that, John Lanchute, because we were together on that Southeast Leamington thing for years. You know that we cared. But right now, there's nothing that we can do to fix this. And I'm sorry that we can't fix it better to your satisfaction, but that's where we are.
So I have a motion on the floor. Ready for the vote? All in favor of the motion to receive? Opposed? Was that up? I can't tell. Councillor Dunn? So it's a tie vote, but in the end it doesn't really matter, because we'll be receiving the minutes and this report's received anyway. So. Pardon?
Just to confirm that once it's on the agenda, it's redeemed.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is a delegation from Tourism Windsor, Essex Peel Island, Mr. Gordon Orr, and fellow teammates.
Good evening. Good evening, Your Worship, and members of Leamington Municipal Council. My name is Gordon Orr. I'm the CEO of Tourism Windsor Essex Peely Island, and I'm joined tonight by Lynette Bain, our Vice President of Tourism Programs and Development, and Mr. Chris Racine, our Director of Marketing and Special Events. We're here tonight as part of a commitment that we made when we assumed the leadership roles of Tourism Windsor Essex Peely Island. We promised that we would attend council meetings on a regular basis, not only at the city and the county council level, but also at the local level, like we're here tonight. At each town council meeting. This is the sixth of nine visits we're doing this month. And we do this for a couple of reasons. First, we want to make sure our elected officials are better informed about the importance of tourism as an economic generator and job creator. And secondly, we want to provide you the opportunity to ask any questions that you may have of us in this forum. We were last here in these chambers about a year ago on June 6, 2016, and it's good to be back. Tonight, we're here with the latest edition of our 2017-2018 visitor guide, which was just released in the middle of April. And we have a brief PowerPoint presentation, which will be followed by the premiere of our new regional tourism video. Okay, so there we are. Our vision, mission, mandate, to become a top-of-mind destination offering authentic and diverse visitor experiences. Our mission, to become a tourism industry collaborative committed to enhancing the region's economy and quality of life. Our mandate, our four core functions there, marketing communications, visitor services, event attraction, and product and program development. Am I doing this right? Okay, that's good, thank you. Slide, there we go, there. And as our organizational structure, you can see our slide is an 11-member board. It's a mix of politicians and stakeholders. You can see on our executive that Mayor Santos is our board chair on county, and county council is also represented by directors Warden Bain and Mayor Patterson, for which we appreciate Mayor Patterson's active participation and leadership in this regard. Next slide, please. We are guided by a 5-year strategic plan, which operates under three strategic directions: growing the tourism industry and visitor experiences, maximizing key industry partnerships and relationships, and building our capacities to support the tourism industry. Lynette?
Thank you, Gordon. When we look back at what we accomplished together within a united visitor industry, we put together a comprehensive document that was actually circulated to Council in early March. We're going to highlight just a few of our more noteworthy accomplishments for you tonight. We were the recipients of the 2016 Ontario Culinary Tourism Award for the Best Ontario Culinary Tourism Experience with our EPIC Passport. And that was accepted by TWEPI and the EPIC Wine Growers Association at the Tourism Summit this past year. We were also a finalist as the Ontario Culinary Tourism Leadership Award. And we were the winner of the Motor City's National Heritage Areas Award for Excellence in Tourism for the launch of the Henry Ford Audio and Driving Tours. In destination development, we hosted 4 targeted workshops centered around topical and useful themes for our stakeholders: birding tourism, two-wheeled tourism, that was cycling and motorcycling, TripAdvisor, and social media. We also, in 2016, slide, launched the Barrels, Bottles, and Brews Trail, and it was designed to celebrate the burgeoning craft brew industry combined with our distilleries, including Craft Whiskey and Vodka, and our iconic brands J.P. Weiser's and Canadian Club. We developed a regional tourism committee with town and municipal staff charged with the tourism portfolio in their day-to-day work in an effort to enhance communications and harness synergies of working together collectively. The Waterfront Trail on Peely Island, there you can see the Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport, Eleanor McMahon, with Gordon Orr at the launch of the Waterfront Trail on Peely Island. In event development, we hosted 4 signature events, 2 in sports tourism and 2 conventions that attributed significantly to our healthy hotel occupancies and higher than average daily rates. In marketing, in slide, the 60 Days, 60 Reasons is a social media campaign that ran over the summer that featured day trip itineraries. And our Best of Windsor Essex campaign is a social media campaign designed to have the locals tell us where the visitors would want to go. And the Windsor Essex Staycation Giveaway and Expo is a partnership with Devonshire Mall to host a tourism megaplex of 30 exhibitors promoting to 20,000 daily mall visitors. Social media contests also ran to help support staying closer to home this vacation season. In social media marketing, you can see we've had some tremendous growth in all of our social media platforms and for our website.
Slide, please. There you can see for Canada 150 celebrations, we designed a logo. And much like the Canada 150 logo, we wanted to, rather than create a new one, we wanted to modify ours to match the branding and the color concepts of Canada 150. Slide, please. We also wanted to create a regional hub at we150.ca that promoted tourism-related activities as they relate to Canada 150. This hub is searchable by event and or by community, and we also created the hashtag We150 to encourage folks to share what they experience. Slide, please. Our marketing plan and destination development strategy for 2017-2018 includes the following four areas of focus. They are arts and culture, in particular cultural districts and art initiatives, outdoor adventure, which is two-wheeled adventures and waterfront, food and drink, which includes culinary and wine barrels, bottles, and brews, and under the entertainment category, gaming, events, and shopping. Slide, please. Our Plenty of Reasons ad campaign continues, recognizing that we were blessed with many tourism assets with no one iconic attraction. We decided to highlight plenty of reasons to visit and plenty of reasons why you'll love this place. Slide, please.
To capitalize on the continuation of the strong U.S. dollar and to capture more of the U.S. leisure market, we will launch, with the help of our tourism partners and the Ontario Tourism Marketing Partnership Corporation, a campaign centered around our Plenty of Reasons to Visit creative in Q3 and Q4 of this year. You can see on the screen the list of funding partners so far who have contributed to this $100,000 campaign. We applied for and were successful in being awarded $30,000 from the OTMPC through their Tourism Industry Partnership Program Fund, for which we are grateful. In an effort to build upon our capacities to support our stakeholders in a secure, convenient, efficient, and effective way, we recently created a partner portal. This portal was tested during the solicitation of sales for the visitor guide that started in January. Feedback so far has been positive. The portal is being used for updating stakeholder information, uploading photos and submitting events to the calendar, the download of industry reports, and for soliciting partnership opportunities. We recently, this June, launched the Coffee Trail, and it's something that promotes local businesses in Windsor, Essex, who serve quality artisanal coffee, and it's the first of its kind in Ontario. We have created a landing page on our existing website exclusive to members of the trail, demonstrating what makes their location and coffee unique. On the screen, next slide, we're looking at year-over-year performance indicators. For 2016 versus 2015, more Americans came by car. That's a 4% increase. Also, more people flew into YQG, our international airport, over 40% growth. Our hotel figures are very encouraging and seeing some positive growth, and our marketing efforts have driven traffic to our website and grown some of our social media channels. Next slide.
Thank you, Lynette. For first quarter, next slide, please. Year over year, you can see growth in our hotel occupancy by about 1.5%, with close to a $5 increase in the average daily room rate. And slide, please. And you can see there all of our social media platforms have also seen positive growth. Slide, please. You can see the cover, of course, the color concepts and some of the internal design of the visitor guide. It grew to 88 pages this year, based on demand, whether it be through advertising listings or advertisements. We print 95,000 copies of these guides, and we distribute them throughout Ontario, Michigan, and Ohio. And of course, the front cover concept should look quite familiar to many of you. June, or all of you, I should say. June is Tourism Month, and we have a number of activations planned to celebrate the importance of tourism industry and to celebrate all the good work that is happening within a United Visitor industry. Slide, please. Also this month, we had our annual general meeting on June 8th at the Capitol Theater, and we had some heavy hitters as speakers relevant to the tourism industry. Beth Potter is the president and CEO of the Tourism Industry Association of Ontario, known as TIO, and the Honorable Elnor McMahon, Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport, joined approximately 120 people in attendance. Slide, please. For you golfers out there, our next networking function is Monday, September the 18th at Kingsville Golf and Country Club. Save the date. Your Worship, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank a few key members of your staff that we work with on a regular basis to help move the tourism portfolio forward. Of course, Kira Knapp, her incoming replacement, Veronica Samick, and from your communications department, Lindsay Gammon, have all been very, very helpful. So thank you very much for your time this evening, and more importantly, for continuing to invest in tourism and your support of Tourism Windsor Essex Pelee Island. We'd like to conclude by showing you our new regional video, and then we'd be happy to take any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Questions from council? Councillor Dunn.
Through you, Your Worship. My question is regarding the Hiram Walker. We went, toured that when you had the AMO,
yes.
And there was rumor that it might not be offering the tours. Are they going to open it up for tours? What's going on with that?
Thank you for the question, through Your Worship, to the councillor. They did, in effect, stop doing tours and opening it to the public at the end of March of this year. I know that there's movement made afoot to try and keep the Brand Center open in some capacity, but nothing has been firm to date. So as it stands now, the Brand Center will continue to be closed until such time as a situation has been resolved. But it is certainly our hope that it will be remain a viable tourism asset in our own backyard. And we are trying to work some sort of a Walkerville whiskey distillery for that area, because it is growing. As you may know, J.P. Weiser's through Hiram Walker, they're looking at opening it up to public tours, but at this time it's still not open to the public. So right now we rely heavily, of course, on Wolf Head and Amherstburg.
Councillor Jacobs, yeah.
Thank you, Worship. Very picturesque book, but I'm very disappointed. And the reason I'm disappointed is that I went through this, and I did it quite rapidly, excluding the advertisements that are paid for, I presume, to be put in the book or whatever, from different corporations. Leamington is mentioned 5 times during this whole book. And I really feel that we got the short end of the stick of this. Am I off base or what?
Well, thank you for the question, through Your Worship, to the councillor. I think that that is a very quick look at it. I know that we did count the number of listings that we had this year over last year in the book, and there are more there are more listings in the book from Leamington, and I would have to report back to you after we read through the booklet ourselves if you want us to count the number of impressions that Leamington has made in the book. We could certainly do that for you, but it's a lot more than 5.
I'm not going to, you know, sit here and argue about it.
Sure.
But I just did a quick, you know, leaf through, like looking at page to page and page, and excluding the advertisements, I came up with four. Councillor Wilkinson came up with the fifth one. I missed Tillman Marsh in there. Was that? And like I say, I guess I just feel that the short end of the stick on this, and I'm not being disrespectful by any means, but I don't know, maybe we're missing something or we're not doing something or whatever, but I'm curious. Thank you.
Well, I think you are doing something, and certainly we do have a lot of the assets of Leamington in the booklet. So what I'd like to do, if it's all right with your worship, is go through that exercise, and we'll get back to you with the number of mentions and where and what pages you can find Leamington mentioned in the book, and then see if you still have the same conclusion. Okay.
Okay. Any other questions from council? See none. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Next item on the agenda is a report regarding special events in Leamington. Ms. Percy?
So the municipality of Leamington recognizes the importance of special events in enhancing quality of life, tourism, culture, and recreation, and in providing economic benefits to the local economy. Each year, there are a number of special events held in Leamington, including runs, walks, festivals, fairs, parades, and public gatherings. The planning and management of an event often requires coordinated efforts of the event organizer, volunteers, agencies such as the OPP and Health Unit, and municipal staff. Feedback received from organizers said it's difficult to determine what permits and licenses are required in order to hold a special event and to navigate through the municipal approvals. So in order to address that feedback, a special event guide was developed and a new special event application was created. The guide is designed to help event organizers navigate through all requirements. A special event permit will be issued once all the affected municipal departments have been informed of the event, that all health and safety guidelines have been met, and that all necessary permits, permissions, insurance, and approvals are secured. So the intent is that the new process will begin immediately. There will be a planned public education session for event organizers, whereby administration will review the guide, the application forms, and the process, and answer any questions. So the recommendation before council is just to receive the report.
Thank you very much. Councillor Jacobs moves. Councillor Hammond support. Comment?
Your worship, yes, thank you. Brenda, that was a great job that you've done on that. I'm assuming you and your staff put that together. For special events, that'll answer a lot of questions people have out there. Really did a nice job on that. Thank you.
Further discussion? Calling the vote then, all in favor? And carried. Thank you. Move on to the next report, and I know we've been waiting with bated breath for Lindsay to come forward and talk to us about the audited financial statements. Well, Ginny's going to start us off, I'm sorry, but Lindsay's here as well, so there we go.
Mr. Mayor and Council, this report presents the 2016 audited consolidated financial statements for the municipality for your approval and requests that Council approve the auditors for next year. In the attached financial statements, you'll find that the external auditors have provided a clean audit opinion, meaning in general that there are no material misstatements in the 2016 financial statements. The 2016 fiscal year ended with a cumulative net surplus position of approximately $269 million, being an increase of $12 million from the prior year. This surplus results from certain projects certain capital projects that were not completed in the year, and these projects were from the following departments: Parks, Sewers, Engineering, Marina, and Drainage. The surplus also resulted from increased investment income and bank interest earned, increased supplemental tax revenues, decreased storm sewer maintenance, and reduction in insurance costs. Please also note that on May 29, 2017, administration submitted the 2016 financial information return to the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing as required each year. So in conclusion, administration requests that the 2016 audited consolidated financial statements for the municipality of Leamington be approved, that administration be authorized to publish the 2016 audited financial statements on the municipal website, and that Hicks McPherson Iatona and Dreger be appointed as the external auditors for the municipality of Leamington for the 2017 fiscal year, which will be year three of a five-year agreement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jenny. Are there any questions from council in that regard? Lindsay, did you have input in, or just here for questions in case B? Okay. What are council's wishes then? Councillor Dunn moves the recommendation, support by Councillor Jacobs. Discussion on the motion? All in favor? And carried. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is recommendation act or an idea regarding application for sign variance from Brad's Butcher Block. So Lisa, oh, there you are, okay. We'll have you present first and then we'll go from there.
Good evening. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak regarding the projection signage application that we have recently submitted. In June 2016, we were approved for a CIP grant after submitting the concept drawings shown here. Is it going? Okay. We were told then that we could apply for a variance for our projection sign as they were not permitted within the current bylaws. The sign that we are seeking variance on is permitted within most, if not all, of the municipalities in Essex County. In my opinion, they add a nice impact to quaint districts, which is ideally the impression that we are looking to give within Uptown Leamington as well. In addition to the dimension and image that these signs provide within an uptown, they also help to direct pedestrians to the stores that they are passing, while preventing them from having to strain to look at signs located above their heads on fascias. The outline of the sign bylaw intent is provided here. Go to. And it is my belief that the sign that we are applying for does meet most of the intentions of this bylaw. The bylaw was intended to regulate the number, size, and location of signs, help the public identify facilities, businesses, and services without difficulty, ensure signage is compatible with the surroundings while protecting and enhancing the aesthetic qualities and visual character of Leamington, and lastly, prevent signage from being a distraction or hazard. The sign that we are asking to install will extend approximately 36 inches from the wall and will be approximately 8 to 9 feet above the sidewalk. This will not only help pedestrians, but I feel that it will also help customers who are driving down Mill Street, as many find it hard to look at fascia signs while driving down this street because cars are coming from both sides and there are driveways along it as well. It is my belief that this type of signage is very professional, tidy, aesthetically appealing, and very compatible with the surroundings and will not create a hazard or distraction. I do understand that Mill Street is preparing to undergo an exciting revitalization, and I thank Council for taking the initiative to implement this endeavor. I look forward to its completion, and I feel that this type of signage will be a beautiful addition to the concept, although I'm sure I'm a little biased. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Percy, did you want to, are you, or is it, oh, Ruth, I'm sorry, Ruth.
Thank you, Mayor Patterson. You have my report in front of you, and you can see in the report what the bylaw actually lists as its intent, and that's on the first page of the report under the background, so I won't go over that. Just to indicate that a projection sign, the definition within the bylaw is that it's a sign attached to and projecting from the face of a building, where the sign face is not parallel to the face of the building to which is attached. And you did see in Lisa's presentation some examples of that. And you can also see that a typical sign would encroach over municipal property, and that's usually a sidewalk in most cases. Permitting those signs would require appropriate standards of construction, design, and engineering, of course, and some parameters regarding where they might be located so they don't block other projection signs, if other projection signs might be approved or later incorporated into the sign bylaw. So my comments regarding the application, again, as are set out in the report, and I'll just reiterate them quickly, there is a planned report regarding the revitalization of Mill Street. There will be a consultant that is retained in order to provide that report. So in my opinion, the request for a variance is premature in that once the report and some idea as to how we're moving forward with that Mill Street revitalization is brought forward to council, we can also look at whether it is appropriate to incorporate projection signs into the sign bylaw itself in relation to Mill Street and potentially all of Leamington. But in my opinion, it would be most appropriate to get that report, have the consultant give us some parameters and some regulation regarding those projection signs, where they might be permitted, how they might be permitted, and how it's most appropriate to move forward in a larger scale. So those are my submissions.
Okay, thank you very much. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Your Worship. Ruth, expecting a report like this, what would be the timelines? I know that we're looking at doing some revitalization and so forth, but could you, like for Mrs. Brad, I would think, to, you know, for her business and so forth, what are the expected dates that something like this would be complete?
That should be completed by the end of the year. It is budgeted for this year to have that consultant retained, and I would expect in consultation with Mr. Sharon that we'd be looking at that report by the end of the year. He can perhaps add to that. I don't want to speak for him, but we did have a discussion earlier today.
Mr. Sharon.
Thank you, Mayor Patterson. It is on our list of projects to get done this year, certainly the first half of the year. And we're doing about four times the capital work this year than we traditionally used to do. So it's a very busy season. We've been devoting the first half of this year to getting this year's projects up and running, certainly looking to the latter half of the year to prepare for next year's potential projects, which is meaning the actual construction. This year, we're still planning on getting the design work done. So before the end of the year, I think is fair. It's looking at Alan because, you know, there's a lot of projects on the list, but as of right now, that's still our expectation.
If I may, Your Worship, the reason I'm asking this is simply because I hate to see something that would be delaying, you know, a prolonged delay, I guess. I know what we're looking at. You know, we want to have some uniformity and make things all look, I guess, aesthetic to the eye. However, you know, undue delays, I would think, cause, you know, some hardships for individuals as well. So, thank you.
Deputy Mayor.
Well, how I look at it, we did the design of Mill Street and we did the design of the Uptown Core without any consultant's plan. And we, I guess, went out on a limb. And maybe some people could accuse us of putting the cart before the horse. And maybe people would consider the Bratz putting the cart before the horse. But once in a while, I find that quite admirable. I think every once in a while somebody needs to take charge and say, look, here's a great idea, let me run with it. I have no problems with this sign. I think we can use it as a marker going forward. I'm glad that they're willing to invest in the Uptown. I'm seeing them as an example for other people that are considering investing in Uptown, so I have no problem with this at all. And I will certainly support it. At some point, I'm happy to make the motion, but I'd like to hear a few of the other councillors. But I'm definitely, definitely for this.
Mr. Neufeld.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think administration is also for it. It's the timing of it and the mechanics behind it. So, for example, how do we know what the standards are to go forward? Will we be doing these on a one-off basis? Is the structure of the brackets, are they sufficient to hold the sign? We don't know that, the size of the signs. So this is the kind of work that we need to do in behind to ensure that when we do move in this regard, because we think it, we too believe it's a good idea, but we need some standards. How big can a sign be? What's the weight of it? What's the liability that occurs with it? And what are the materials that can be used and the colors? And all of those sorts of questions are the sorts of things that we take into consideration when we look at these things. So it's, administration certainly doesn't want to hold things up, but there is a natural progression that we need to look at when we're looking at these sorts of issues. And that really is one of the main concerns for administration.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Your Worship. Ruth, I understand where you're coming from in your report here. I appreciate and respect what the current bylaw says, but much like what Deputy Mayor McDonald just said, I think every once in a while, you're right, I like the way you put it, we need to step out on a limb. I'm thrilled to see that Uptown merchants are doing their part here and want to continue to enhance and upgrade the appearance of their storefront. We don't want to lessen that, or we want to encourage that type of activity. What I really appreciate here this time, Lisa, is that you recognize that this improvement you want to make is not allowed by our current bylaw, and yet you come before council and say, I realize this isn't what we're wanting to do isn't allowed, but I'm asking for permission. So often we've seen examples here where construction companies, they go off and do their own thing, or homeowners go off and do their own thing without coming for permission. You know, they try and do things behind the scenes themselves, and maybe that's what's led to some of our challenges we have uptown as well. I've looked at the bylaw very much this weekend. I used to be very familiar with it, but this new bylaw I'm not as familiar with. And then I've looked at your request, and I think the points that are highlighted here on page 55, points A through G, I think your proposal meets them all. I do. I really do. Uptown has many challenges. We all know the list. It's going to be frustrating some days, and I don't think this is going to be something that hurts our uptown. I think this is only going to help it. I say we support this variance. In addition, I think we provide direction here to staff to change the bylaw. I used to be involved in the sign business quite heavily, and we used to make signs like this, not for this community. I'd have to tell people, can't do it in Leamington, but meanwhile, we'd have one being built in a shop that was going to Kingsville, and they were some of the prettiest signs we ever made, went and hung in the town of Kingsville. To Peter's comments there, about the weight, we hung awnings. Awnings could be almost described as a projection sign too. You know, the old Feldman's awning, I redid that one probably in 1999 when it became the Wellness Center. And I think that thing probably weighs over 2,500 pounds. It's 35 feet long, if I remember right. It's a big structure up there on the wall. This here is a hollow aluminum sign, and it's less than 3 feet. I feel a hell of a lot safer walking under your sign than I do the big Feldman's awning downtown and many other big awnings we got downtown. I do have a bit of experience in that regard. So I too will be supporting this wholeheartedly. I hope it goes, and I look forward to seeing the sign up there. Thank you.
Councillor Perbicky.
For the mayor, thanks. I guess I'll start with the first one, is that can Bratz not be the template? Cannot they make it to specs? And if somebody else comes before, get all your perimeters like right away. I frequent Mill Street 6 times a week. I have seen people drive past Bratz and then back in, or circle a couple times because there's no parking. That's another story. And I'm glad there is a bylaw, and I know our bylaw guys are busy, but I'd rather see a sign on a building than all the other stuff we have with the papered up windows and no sign at all. You don't know what it is. I mean, I thought we gave authority, or administration has a quicker chance to go forward and start finding people, start leveling things. So, I mean, I'd like to see this thing go forward too, so, and all the other signs cleaned up, people, too. So that's all my comment is.
If I could, Councillor the specs that you want to use, whose are they? Where do they come from? Because they're not in our bylaw.
Well, you know, here we go again, Worthy Mayor. I don't have a ring on my finger, but beside me, do I do have a professional sign maker, so I would trust his knowledge of the sign. And we do have other sign makers here, too. Just get a blueprint of this and pass it around to the experts that are in this town.
What if I don't like the size of the sign? I want mine bigger.
This is what you're going to set, and this is what you're going to get. I'm telling you, if you make it 30 inches, I mean, I'm terrified of walking down the street with those flower pots thinking I'm going to get hit in the head one of these days. So, I mean, you can't start saying projectors off the sidewalk. I mean, I had a restaurant uptown, and we redid that awning on top of there, too, and the five of us stood on there and put it up. We painted that building, and that thing weighs a lot. So, I mean, you can't, it's on the sidewalk, so, I mean, we're going to have to call everything then a hazard. But you if you're going to make a standard, use this as a template and go from there. No more, no less.
But you'd have that built into a bylaw, is what you're
saying.
Oh, yeah,
for sure. Okay. But I would like to have a test one first done, too, to show what it is. Have a dummy made up. I'm sure somebody can get a dummy made up and just to show people what this is what we're projecting. If you're making Mill Street your one-way and angle parking and the hippest place to be, then these signs need to be there.
Okay. Councillor Dunn.
Through you, Your Worship. I love the sign. I love the concept. I absolutely do. I think projection signs should be, we should probably change our bylaw to include the projection signs. But the fact that you're here now, the next person coming forward, in my opinion, we could have anybody coming with a bigger sign, whatever. I would love to see a standard or something so that everybody conforms. Like they said, one might be bigger than yours. You won't even be able to see yours then. So that's why, and you understand the sign bylaw because you've been adamant about that, very forceful, and I appreciate that, with making sure that people have a proper sign. And that's why I love the idea, and I'd love to see you have a projection sign, but at this point in time, I'd like to see it put into the bylaw, and then that's what I would support. Thank you.
Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'd like to go back to our CAO's comment there regarding the structure and of this. How would we achieve that? Like, would everyone have to bring forward an engineer's report, Peter, or something? That is a concern, and I have to go along with that as well, that we want something that's safe.
Mr. Neufeld.
Yeah, I'm not really sure how to answer that. I suppose if we don't have a standard within a bylaw, then we're going to have one-offs until we do. So how do we go about getting a standard? I suppose we would hire a consultant to help us figure out what are the safe weights, how far it can hang out from the wall. I mean, you know, I don't really know how to answer that except to say we prefer to have the standards set before we have people starting to take steps. Because it's easy to say, well, to just use this one as the template, but the problem with that is we don't know that this template is actually a safe template. We don't know that. Perhaps, yes, it's aluminum, but so are the brackets. What are the angles? What are the distances? I mean, the further out something is from the fulcrum, the more weight it can distribute on the lever. So I don't know how to answer that, Councillor Jacobs, except to say I would feel much more secure if we had the opportunity to write the bylaw with that in mind.
Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. I too think that, you know, in light of the fact that we're talking about the revitalization of the downtown and specifically Mill Street and some things moving forward, I mean, I'm in favor of the sign, but in order to try to accommodate some of the concerns raised by Peter and others here, I think that there's not a great deal of specification on this particular sign, Lisa. I'll give you an example. It says anchored to the steel siding with using self-tapping screws. We have somebody in the audience that builds a lot of houses and stuff, and I don't know that he would agree that tapping using self-tapping screws into aluminum siding is going to hold that sign. I'll be honest with you. And Tony, I'm using you as a reference. And so having said that, and I have a feeling that this is going to pass, but I think it needs to pass with some kind of jurisdiction put around it or some kind of perimeters. And I think that What needs to be done here is you need to have, because are you going to get up on the ladder and do it? Who is going to do it? That's what I'm getting to. There needs to be a qualified sign person, whether it be in the days when Tim did it, or a qualified sign person that say, wait a minute, using self-tapping screws into aluminum siding isn't going to work, isn't going to hold that. So I think that there needs to be a little more in terms of depth of your diagram. You know, you're showing a 2x2 aluminum square, but it doesn't talk about the supporting bracket and all of those things. So, I mean, at the very least, even if it does pass, I think you need to come up with something a lot more in detail than that, and the sign company that's going to do it, so that their reputation is on the line with how that's anchored to the building.
Deputy Mayor.
All I wanted to say is that we're not reinventing the wheel, or we're not trying to actually invent the wheel. To me, it's done in neighboring communities. I saw Kingsville, I saw Amherstburg. Certainly, there are guidelines in place that can be followed, and I'm certain that sign makers follow them. They're not just going to come up with some half-baked idea. They know that that has to be anchored to the wall, because ultimately, they'd be liable as well as the store owner. To me, we get so bogged down in the process that we lose people. We lose interest, we lose enthusiasm, we lose everything because the process is so long. And I don't mean this disrespectfully to staff. To me, for us to say, you know what, this is a great idea, let's plug our noses, jump off the edge for a change. Let's do something that's not so darn bogged down in the process. We're not the first municipality to come up with signs like this. They're not the first store owner to come up with signs like this. To me, we're trying to break outside of the box. We're trying to punch our way out. And then every time that we do, we meet so much resistance. It's a sign. It's a sign. There's my frustration in it. And then I can imagine when people come forward and want to do something, we say, well, no, the rules, the bylaws say we can't do that. I just think we're missing an opportunity here. It's not that big of a deal. We work together. And we go forward from there. I would just like us for once to take a step. It's not blind. We're just taking a step outside of the norm. I will make the motion that we allow the variance for this sign because I think it's a brave new world, and I want to be part of being gutsy.
Motion on the floor. Is there a seconder? Councillor Wilkinson seconds. Any discussion on the motion? I do. So I love these signs, love projection signs, but I'm siding with administration. I think administration is making sure that our assets are covered. I think it is premature. If Bratz put one up where they've got it on their building, according to this drawing, and if I own the building next to it, and we've dealt with this before where neighbors don't always get along, and I'm thinking, okay, well, if they can put up a projection sign, so can I. Mine's going to be bigger. And it's going to be right beside it because there's no regulations in place. And we can't stop them because we've said yes to the rats. We're going to have to say yes to the neighbors. So from my perspective, I get where everybody's coming from, and I'm happy to hear even administration supports the possibilities of these projection signs. I just think we need to be better prepared with the rules and regulations before we say yes to something like this. And that's my position on it. So, motion on the floor. Any more comments? If not, then I will call the vote. All those in favor of the motion to proceed outside of our recommendations, however you wanted to put it. 4 in favor, 5 in favor, opposed. 2 opposed, motion carries. Next report is one regarding the reconsideration of cat, spay, and neuter voucher programs. Ms. Percy.
Your Worship, if Council can bear with me, we have some housekeeping things to do with respect to reconsidering the report that follows this report on the agenda. So Council considered cat spay and neuter voucher program on March 21st, 2016. A number of motions were put on the floor and they were defeated. So then Council received a delegation from a gentleman at the May 23rd meeting who was speaking to Council with respect to cat control and feral cats. Council passed a motion that the current trap program established with Public Works Department be maintained. Educational information on how to humanely deter cats from